And welcome back to another episode of Focus on Tomorrow. Focus on Tomorrow is a nonprofit organization which is located in Chicago, Illinois. You can find us on the web at www.focus-on-tomorrow.org, or you can email us at info@focus-on-tomorrow.org. And remember, if you have any questions or comments, you can call us now at 312-738-1060. And today we are featuring EverThrive Illinois. And with me we have Janine Lewis, who is our executive director. How you doing today?
Good.
I just want to thank you so much for coming out for the show. But the first question we want to ask you is, EverThrive has been around since 1988, am I right?
Yeah.
So you think you give us like a brief history on EverThrive and what tell us about your mission?
Sure. So for our 26-year history, we've always focused on advocacy and programmatic efforts to improve the health of women, children, and families over the lifespan. So for 25 of our 26 years, we were known as the Illinois Maternal and Child Health Coalition. And we were formed as a coalition. We brought together interested parties in the late 80s because we were focused on increasing and expanding categorical eligibility for Medicaid for pregnant women. And we thought that the state of Illinois was doing that a little slower than we thought they should. And so when we were successful with that, we figured, oh, there's some other maternal and child health issues that we might be able to work on. Currently, we focus on five different initiative areas, which are healthcare reform, immunizations, health disparities, healthy lifestyles, and child and adolescent health. So we've really expanded our portfolio, but our mission, you know, really is still the same, which is to improve the health of women, children, and families over the lifespan. And we do that by community engagement, partnerships, education, and advocacy work.
So there are over 90 organization members under the EverThrive Coalition, am I right?
Yes.
So how does having so many members help you advocate for a healthier community?
I think our power and our strength is really in our numbers. So we have, you know, 90 organizational members through a variety of different areas. So members come to us through our five initiative areas. We actually do three chapter groupings across the state, one in Chicago, of course, one in Lake County, and one in the southern area of our state in Mount Vernon. And so it really helps us advocate for those that professionally may not be able to advocate as virtue of their positions, but definitely see that they have a role and want to be a voice for women, children, and families. So we think that our strength is in numbers, and we really take our responsibility in representing those constituencies really, really seriously.
So there are a lot of different issues that EverThrive can advocate for. So how do you guys prioritize which policy to include on your agenda?
Sure. So really thinking about our policy agenda usually is beginning in the previous legislative session. So usually in Illinois, our legislative session goes from the end of January to the end of May. And so during that time, we're figuring out what things we have been successful on, what things have been pending, and which things we kind of need to regroup and strategize for the next upcoming legislative session. So what we do is we talk with the steering committees of our five initiative areas. We talk with our chapter membership. We talk with our organizational membership. Of course, our policy agenda has to be approved by our board. And we also think it's really important to talk to other advocacy groups. So every December, we host what we call a health advocates meeting, and we all bring together our policy agendas for the upcoming legislative session and compare them to see if there are points of synergy that we can work together.
And what exactly have you guys worked with so far for the legislative?
Sure. So in the past legislative session, we worked hard to secure passage of the Pregnant Women Fairness Act, which makes sure that we have reasonable accommodations for pregnant women who are working, such as having, you know, frequent breaks or being able to drink water, really basic things that we think all employers in Illinois should be allowing their pregnant workers to be able to do. And we focused on a number of things. We focus on the budget. We focus on protecting revenues that support both at the federal and state level, women and children's programming. Right now, we're focused on the minimum wage, and we'd like to see that increase. We do a lot of work on increasing social determinants of health, and one of those definitely is making sure that our citizens are have ways to get out of poverty.
Can you talk to us about that?
Sure. So in our health disparities work, we have been working for the past 10 years or so on a campaign that we call the Campaign to Save Our Mothers and Babies. So we are focused on reducing racial and ethnic disparities in infant mortality, which is babies dying before their first birthday, and also maternal mortality. So this is women who are dying with complications related to childbirth. And so we think that unfortunately those disparities are growing. Although infant mortality rates are decreasing overall, the disparity between black and white infants dying is actually slightly increasing, and that's not what we want to see. And so we focus a lot on thinking about things in that program from a three-pronged perspective, thinking about it from an advocacy perspective, advocating for things like minimum wage and advocating for increased access to healthcare. So that's where a lot of our healthcare work falls into play. Mm-hmm. And then working on educating families. So we educate women in Englewood. We have an office that is very important to us. Our second office space is in Englewood community, and we have staff members that were born and bred and work in Englewood and live in Englewood, so they're very connected to that community. And you know, we educate providers. We also educate women inside the Cook County jail system, because we think that it's very important that they know how to strategize and make provisions for their infants.
Awesome. So going back to the mortality rate that you said that was declining, there is a quite, you know, the disparity between African American and Caucasian babies. So why do you think that is, and how do you address that issue?
Mm-hmm. So I think it's really complicated, and I don't mean that to be vague. I just think that we're not going to find a magic bullet that will help us figure out, oh, this was what we were looking for all along, that was going to reduce the disparities concerning infant mortality. I think it's the big hairy issues that we all know about, but aren't always sure how to tackle. So things like the reduction of poverty, things like in the increasing the equality and access to healthcare, the issue of racism, institutional racism, you know, these are things that many of us are really working towards reducing. We obviously haven't gotten there yet, but I think, you know, it's worth that fight, and it's worth talking and continuing to be open and honest about that dialogue.
Of course, most importantly, it is. So one of the campaigns is called, you said, Campaign to Save Our Mothers and Babies, mm-hmm. in which addresses infant mortality again, right?
Yes.
So going back to it, it says, can you tell me more about your plan to eliminate this issue within the next 25 years?
Yeah.
That's a pretty big rate, 25 years.
We have no lack of ambition at EverThrive. So we would like to see it eliminated in 25 years. So that really is inside one generation. I think we can do it if we're willing to tackle the big, hairy issues. I think we are on our way. I think I'm doing some work and looking at some of the life course indicators with our colleagues at the Illinois Department of Public Health. And when you look at things like homicide or incarceration rates or educational levels, reading levels at third grade, at eighth grade, you understand how early and how insidious these predictors right. of things like infant mortality and maternal mortality start very, very young. And so, you know, we know, you know, with reading and math levels in third to eighth grade, who, you know, might, you know, be able to get a job that pays a living wage. So these are things that we know. We have the data. We know what to look for. We know what the indicators are. And I think as a state and as a city, we just need to put our money where our mouth is and really focus on supporting quality education, supporting programs that help families eat healthier and get out of poverty and support themselves. We want families to be self-sufficient.
Self-sufficient, exactly how?
So I think a number of ways. I mean, my goal and our work at EverThrive is always about training the trainer. So our goal is to give people educational and support tools so that they can better their surroundings and their community. So, for example, one of the ways that we do that is through our Cooking Matters program. So Cooking Matters is a new program for us. We acquired lead agency status for Illinois in February of 2013, but it's a culinary demonstration and nutrition education program for lower income families.
And how exactly that come about?
Well, it came about over 20 years ago nationally. So Share Our Strength is a national nonprofit organization, anti-hunger organization that's based in Washington, D.C. And they actually created the No Kid Hungry campaign. And out of the No Kid Hungry campaign came Cooking Matters. And so you may know that definitely in Illinois, there's over 745,000 children that are at risk for being hungry. So that's basically one in five children is what we would call at risk for hunger. And so with that knowledge and out of that work came the program Cooking Matters. And so it's a national program that's done in many states. We at EverThrive are the lead agency for the state of Illinois. So we do over 130 cooking courses a year in and around the city of Chicago. And last fiscal year, we reached over 1,500 participants.
And this helps them eat healthier, I'm guessing.
It is. So it's always, you know, the stories are always good from that program. So stories where families have not tried different types of fruits and vegetables. They may have never tried an eggplant or, you know, a pomegranate. And to try it, you know, and realize that they like it and that they could incorporate this into their daily and weekly diets, I think is really rewarding. Thinking about healthier ways to prepare some cultural meals that they may have been eating for years has been really great. So it's not only providing nutrition education, but also getting a chance to taste test the knowledge that they get. So they always have a cooking demonstration part. And usually at the end of the course, the families get to take groceries home so that they can make the meals themselves.
And at first, like, how do the families actually react to this type of, like, idea of, like, you know, throwing them healthy? Because I feel like, me personally, I mean, I'm not really big of a healthy eater, but if someone ever tried to give me an idea of, like, trying to eat healthier, I would think, like, first of all, it's really expensive to eat healthy. It's really, really expensive. Then second is, like, I wouldn't even know how to like, engage my kids, me personally, to eat healthier. So my thing is, like, how do people react to it, or even families reacted to it?
So a couple of things. One is that I think when it's not your dollars paying for this new vegetable, it's different. So I think people are more willing to try things when it's in a when it's in a group environment, and two, when I'm not paying for it. But I also, you know, I think to your point about, you know, I don't know how to eat healthy and it seems very expensive. We hear that quite a bit. And to that end, there's a program inside Cooking Matters. We call it Cooking Matters in the Store. Okay. So we actually, every course ends with Cooking Matters at the Store, and we actually go and teach participants how to shop around the perimeter of stores. We typically, we've done hosted elected officials, and we ask them to do the $10 challenge. So they have to use $10. They have to feed a family of four using three of the five food groups, and that's always really fun.
Wait, three of the five food groups with $10 in their pocket, and they have to feed a family of four?
Yes.
That sounds like a challenge.
It is a challenge, but it can be done.
And I think it's great. I mean, I think it's great the fact that you guys are giving the type of education that these people need. But you were also saying that you guys have educational sessions in Cook County Jail.
Yes.
Right? As you were saying, can you talk to us about that?
Yes. So I've been at EverThrive for 4.5 years now. And initially when we forged this relationship with Cook County Jail, we were asked from the case manager that works inside the jail system to come and talk to our pregnant and postpartum women, so women who had recently delivered a baby. And, you know, we weren't sure what to expect, and we didn't know that it would be as long-term as it has been. And so we've been in there now over 3 years, and I actually used to go myself. And, you know, some of the most worthwhile educational work I've probably ever done in my career, because the dialogues that you have with the women inside Cook County Jail, you know, they just like me and you, you know, they have the best wishes for their new infant, and they want to make sure that they provide all the systems and processes that can help that infant be a successful member of society. And so we talk about things like, reducing the risk factors for reducing preterm labor, or having a baby too early before 37 completed weeks of gestation. We talk about how to navigate the system and how to get programs like SNAP and WIC, and how to connect them to maternal and child health programs like Healthy Start, and how to make sure that even inside the Cook County system, that they're exercising, that they're walking, that they're getting fresh fruits and vegetables, and making sure that 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 baby has the best start possible.
And this is really, this is like the first time I'm actually hearing this, because I never thought, like, you know, somebody from Cook County Jail actually pregnant, which is really, really,
they
really,
have
really
a whole
good,
ward, yeah, unfortunately, of pregnant and postpartum women. So last fiscal year, we did over 14 presentations. So we're there more than once a month. And every time we're there, there's 20 to 25 women.
And has this program actually helped the women?
It has. And actually, Cook County, is, as you may know, is somewhat transitional in nature. So women usually are not there for long. Mm-hmm. Either they are going to be released, or they're unfortunately going to do real time at some other penal institution in the state. So they're not there for long. So sometimes, you know, we may see them a couple of months, we may only see them once and then never see them again. But there have been stories where we've seen women, and when once they've gotten out, they have contacted the staff and continued that relationship.
So it kind of like changed them, basically. It kind of gave them more knowledge about, you know, the pregnancy, and actually help them. Mm-hmm. And I mean, what did you get out of it? I mean, personally.
You know, I think some of that work in the jail system, you know, the women were so well educated and so knowledgeable, and they were so they wanted, you know, the best for their child. And I really had some really great dialogues about how to be healthy and what their other childbearing experiences had been like, what their fears were and what their goals were and what they wanted for their reproductive life plan. And, you know, I really probably learned more from them than they learned from me.
Right. And you guys have a variety of classes that you host that are designed for different age groups, right?
We
so
do.
Can you tell us about that?
Sure. So we do a lot of work with youth. So we actually have been doing a texting pilot project. So we're really okay. interested in looking at how texting, not only through our Text for Baby program, which focuses on mothers and fathers and grandparents getting education for healthy pregnancy education for themselves and their families. So that's focused on kind of women of childbearing age and parents of infants under the age one. But we also do texting pilot program. We're doing it in three schools right now in the Chicagoland area, where we're seeing if we text students who attend schools with school-based health centers, which are basically doctors' offices inside schools. If we text them regularly to remind them of their appointment, can we reduce the rate of missed appointments and thus increase morale of the administrative staff in those school health centers? So we have been doing that work. As part of that work, we also have been doing youth health education programs at those three sites. So we've been doing monthly courses with a select group of youth. Oh, wow. So that we talk through, you know, maybe there are other types of health information that they want to share via text. And we want to make sure it comes from their voice and their own words. So and we've been working with them.
So why through, like, why texting? Do you think that's a really new thing to engage on, especially for teenagers?
I don't know if it's new, but I think it's effective. I mean, I think for the teens, you know, in my circle, they may never talk on the phone. If you want to reach them, you're going to have to text it. So I do think texting is the way that many adolescents like to communicate. It's quick. It's fast. Even adults, too. Text for Baby works for adults. I use texting quite a bit. And so I just think that younger populations are more comfortable with that mode of communication. And we want to make health education and access to health care as easy for them as possible. And if texting is the way to do that, then we're glad to do that.
And it even shows, because you guys started with 3,500 users, and now you guys are up to 31,000.
So the Text for Baby, you know, is a free mobile health information service. It's administered nationally by the National Healthy Mothers, Healthy Babies Coalition. And basically, you text baby or bebe if you'd like the messages in Spanish to 511-411, and basically you'll get 3 to 5 messages a week that are timed to where you are in your pregnancy or where the baby is in its first year of life. And you'll get messages like, have you chosen a pediatrician? At your next visit, you should have this test done. This is a recall on car seats. You know, we want to make sure that you don't have this car seat. If you do, you need to return it. So really types of, and it's free to the user. So that's really important. So again, we think it's a way to get out quick information and to have a dialogue. So we've been able to dialogue and get information. We had a module last year where we asked pregnant women, did you get your flu shot? And they could text back yes or no. And if they text back no, then we text them, did you get your flu shot? Did you get your flu shot? And we reminded them until, you know, hopefully they received it, because we think that's really important.
I think that's great. And another reminder, too, if you guys have any more questions about the EverThrive Illinois, you can call us now at 312-738-1060. And now EverThrive is a bigger supporter of the Affordable Care Act. So why do you think so many people out there oppose it?
Yeah, that's a great question. You know, I think there has been, unfortunately, a lot of misinformation about the Affordable Care Act. Mm-hmm. So I think when people actually do the research for themselves, they learn how important some of the provisions are. So, for example, being able to stay on your parents' insurance until age 26, I think has been really, really important. I have a couple of staff members that are on their parents' health insurance as a result, but I think that's been very, very useful. I do think, you know, we as healthcare consumers have to be a little bit more sophisticated, particularly if we're, reviewing plans on the marketplace to purchase our own insurance. But I think that's our job. As Americans and as consumers, we want to make sure that we're choosing the best plan with provisions for our family. So we at EverThrive have educated over 6,000 individuals in this last year alone, both professionals and consumers, about the provisions of the Affordable Care Act. And in our experience, we learned if people really understand and we talk through the major provisions, they're like, oh, that isn't so bad. You know, my preconceptions about it were not correct. And I should also say, you know, we're doing a big push right now.
Okay.
Some of your viewers may know we're in the midst of open enrollment. So this is the second open enrollment phase. It will take us from now until February 15th. So we think it's really important for people who received health insurance on the marketplace last year. It's important that they renew at this time.
And that's good to know. So now that Republicans have the majority of the U.S. House and the Senate, they might try to repeal the Affordable Care Act. So how does EverThrive play a role in preventing this from happening?
Mm-hmm. So, you know, we are very well known for our advocacy efforts, both at the state and federal level. So we have really good relationships with our congressional delegation, and we don't mind going to visit them in D.C. or even seeing them when they're back at home in their in-district location to make sure that they understand how important it is to protect the provisions of the Affordable Care Act. And so, we're facing the Supreme Court decision that's pending right now that might have some implications for how consumers can receive subsidies if they purchase insurance plans on the marketplace. So we'll be watching that closely. Our goal, if we need to get our constituencies and our organizational and consumer membership activated, we have a quick, fast email action alert system where people can easily email their congressional member on a particular issue, and we make it very easy for them. I'm worried most about the defunding of provisions. So there's more than one way to skin a cat. And I think some of the provisions of the Affordable Care Act will be hard to repeal, but if you don't allocate money for it, then you can't do it anyway. So, I think we have to be really careful to watch how funding is allocated in this year and future for the establishment of marketplaces and other pieces of the Affordable Care Act that are very fiscally dependent on federal dollars.
Definitely. And talking about fundraising, do you guys have any type of fundraising events coming up?
We do. So we actually in the spring have our annual adult spelling bee. So that will come up in February or March. It's awesome. So we have 10 teams of two come up to the stage, and we have them spell really hard words. And that money actually goes to support our Youth Advocacy Day. So every spring, we bring down anywhere from 200 to 250 youth advocates and their adult allies to advocate on behalf of the school health center model. And so that takes dollars to bring them down and fund the buses. And so that spelling bee helps do that. We also have our large annual benefit, which is scheduled for September 10th at Salvage One 2015. And that's our biggest fundraiser of the year. And, again, that's supports a lot of our program work and our advocacy work, both in Springfield and in D.C.
That's good to know. And it looks like we have about one more minute left in the show. And do you think you could tell us anything about, tell the viewers any about like the information you can find?
Sure.
Maybe,
so definitely. Our website is www.ilmaternal.org. So www.ilmaternal.org. Our main office number is 312-491-8161. And we'd love to hear from you if you're interested in any of our programs. We'd love to have you.
All right, then, Janine, thank you so much for coming. Sure. I really, really appreciate it. What you're doing at Never Thrive is such a good cause, and I hope everything goes well for you guys.
Thank you.
I have really good confidence in you, and I'm pretty sure you guys will get all those things too. All right. Thank you. So once again, Focus on Tomorrow is a nonprofit organization which is located in Chicago, Illinois. You can find us at the web at www.focus-on-tomorrow.org, or you can email us at info@focus-on-tomorrow.org. I'm your host, Rick Caballero, and I'll see you guys next week.